Harper Audio presents Charlie Martz and Other Stories, The Unpublished Stories by Elmore Leonard. Performed by Will Patton, Mark Bramhall, George Newbern, Tish Hicks, and Nick Toren.
Introduction. More than anyone, you'll see Hemingway's influence in Elmore's early prose. When my father was just starting, he told me he would put a blank piece of paper over the page of a Hemingway story and rewrite the scene his way. It's how he learned to write. I remember when I was 7 or 8, going down the stairs to the basement, seeing my dad at his red desk, a cinder block wall behind him, concrete floor. He was writing longhand on unlined 8.5 by 11 yellow paper. There was a typewriter on a metal stand next to the desk. Across the room was a red wicker wastebasket with balls of yellow paper on the floor around it. Scenes that didn't work, pages that didn't make it. In retrospect, the room looked like a prison cell, but my father, deep in concentration, didn't seem conscious of his surroundings. I said, "Dad, what are you writing?" "A short story called Charlie Martz." I think I said something profound, like, "Oh." Elmore got the name from his best friend, Bill Martz. Bill didn't work as well for the character, so he changed the name to Charlie. While my father was writing the stories in this volume, he worked at Campbell Ewald, an advertising agency, writing Chevrolet ads. For almost a decade, he got up at 5 a.m. and wrote 2 pages of fiction before he went to work. His rule? He couldn't turn the water on for coffee until he wrote a page. This routine continued until Elmore quit the advertising business. One day he said, "I'm going to make my run," which meant he was going to write fiction full-time. These stories also remind me of growing up with my father, eating beans out of tin plates while we watched a Western on TV. My dad said beans tasted better on a tin plate, and he was right. They remind me of playing hide-and-seek with guns. My brothers and sisters and I would hide somewhere in the house, and when Elmore found us, we'd shoot him. He loved the game as much as we did. He was a kid at heart. They remind me of the bullfight poster that hung in our family room, a dramatic shot of Manolete holding his sword and cape ready to finish off a charging bull. Elmore loved the idea of the matador, dressed in his outfit, putting on a show, knowing any mistake might be his last. And they remind me that my father was always writing. I can picture him in the family room, lost in thought, working on Ombre while I was 20 feet away with 2 friends, listening to the new Jimi Hendrix album. Elmore said he wrote 8 pages that afternoon. I can picture him on Easter break in Pompano Beach, Florida, sitting by the pool filled with kids playing and surrounded by their parents talking and drinking vodka and tonics. Elmore, once again oblivious to his surroundings, writing on a yellow pad. In these early stories, you'll see Elmore experimenting with style, trying to find his voice, his sound. You'll see him start a story with weather. You'll see him use adverbs to modify the verb said. You'll see him describe characters in detail, breaking several of the famous 10 rules of writing he developed almost 50 years later. And you'll also see glimpses of Elmore's greatness to come. Peter Leonard.
One horizontal. The joint on Bobien was a semi-black and tan, more black than tan. Any lighter element in the place, disregarding a few beboppers, was sure to be overdressed, on the greasy side, and usually carrying a gun. Since it was of the lower order, and because I was familiar enough with his lower habits, I was willing to bet my last buck Marty Corito would be there. Inside the door, I fought off the Czech girl who had my raincoat half unbuttoned before I could tell her I just wanted a quick warmer and got a blast full in the face from 5 pieces, mostly brass and bongos. Everybody in the place was beating his own time to the jazz. Feet, hands, wooden knockers, in any part of the anatomy near something strong enough to take the beating. The Czech girl said it was Honeysuckle Rose, with not a little enthusiasm. quite a surprise, but I didn't have time to discuss it with her. I spotted my man at the bar. He was slouched on the stool, elbows on the bar, looking like a teddy bear made out of black pinstripe. He was talking to a girl, blonde, looked real, not bad, but not the kind you'd take home to mother. If you could judge by his gestures and the baby stick with me and you can go places look, she'd better have her snowshoes on, laced tight. I'm the kind of guy that gets lovey and buddy-buddy after I've had a few. Only this wasn't the time to be lovey or buddy-buddy or even the least bit nice, for that matter. All evening I had been buying bottle courage for what I was going to do, and now I felt like kissing the guy instead of killing him. Right then, along with the cute feeling, and probably because of it, I got an idea. It added a little color to a drab job. Off to the right, I spotted men in yellow neon, went in, picked one of the more private compartments, of which there were three, closed the door, and pulled a .45 from the left pocket of my raincoat. For the first time since I entered Jade's, I relaxed my grip on the handle. My hand was sweating. I glanced at a couple of jingles and smutty words on the wall and found out that Kilroy had been there. Ordinarily, I wouldn't have laughed, but I was in a peculiar frame of mind. What makes a men's room bring out artistic talents? I decided to think about it later and took the clip out of the gun. I slid the top slug from the clip, put the gun back together and in my pocket again, but kept the slug in my hand when I stepped out. The men's room attendant gave me an unenthusiastic look, saw I wasn't the hand-washing type, but figured what the hell and tried to brush me off. However, he wasted his time. I brushed him instead. Out front, I noticed that Honeysuckle Rose had withered away, and now How High the Moon was being rasped to death by a skinny little colored boy with a great big tenor sax. Everyone was still going nuts, including my man. The stool next to him where the girl had been was now vacant. Either he had missed out, or else she was powdering her nose. I knew he was the type who generally got what he wanted one way or another, so I threw the first guess out and decided I'd better work fast. I squeezed in next to him and put one leg over the empty stool. It took about 10 seconds to get the bartender's eye. I ordered a double, paid, and placed the shot right in front of me. Carrito was so intent on the music, beating on the edge of the bar with his ring turned toward the palm, that he hadn't noticed me yet. I tapped him on the left shoulder, gently. No response. I tapped him again, but with a little more knuckle. Still beating, bouncing, but without taking his eyes off the sax player, he reached a fat, perspiring paw over and held my hand. It took him almost a minute to realize that the hand he held had never used pawns, wasn't lovely, and sure as hell didn't belong to the doll with the blonde hair. I thought he'd spin around and that he might even throw one, but he turned toward me very slowly, probably trying to get his fat brain to turn over fast enough to say something Richard Widmark would if he was sitting there. He looked me right in the eye with his still half closed, took a drag on his cigarette, and blew the smoke in my face slowly. I had planned on being the smooth apple, but he was outsmoothing me. I tried not to blink, put my left hand on the bar, and placed the .45 slug sitting straight up. He didn't notice. I already got a date, pal. I beckoned to the bullet, and he followed my glance. She can have you, Marty. He didn't show surprise that I knew his name. I just want to make a prediction for you. I'm going to kill you with something just like that. I picked up the hooker and took two gulps to kill it, turned from the bar, and walked toward the entrance as naturally as I could. At the check window, I stopped and turned up my collar, part of the show. Then I left fast, without looking back, not part of the show. A checker cab was in front of the place, and I grabbed that. If it hadn't been there, I probably would have taken off like a 220 dash man right down the middle of the street. As soon as I left the bar, I knew I was scared. I hadn't counted on it, but there was nothing I could do about it. All the way across town, I kept looking back, got a few scares, but finally decided that I wasn't being tailed. Then I began to wonder why I wasn't. I had just told the guy I was going to kill him, and he didn't even come after me. I'll bet he didn't hear what I said. What'd you say? The cabbie was looking at me through the rearview mirror. I said, don't you care if the light's red? He jammed on the brakes and I almost ended up next to him. We were on East Adams, downtown Detroit. Since it was close enough, I told him that this was fine, paid, and got out. I stopped in a brass rail to see if he could still get a shot for 35 cents. It didn't take long. 35 cents lighter, I was back outside again. Within 5 minutes, I had picked up the Chevy that I had parked in a lot around a corner and was heading for Grass Lake. It was raining again, and a windshield wiper squeaked a monotonous beat on the downward motion. I opened both of the front window vents wide. The moist air felt good on my face. I relaxed, and for the first time in over a week since I had left Tampico, I breathed more slowly and began to think with a little logic. A year ago, I'd only drive out this way for a swim, and now... I had been in Mexico almost a year when I got the wire telling of Cliff's accident. I was just scrounging around trying to make a fast, easy buck, but legitimately, when the bad news reached me, my brother didn't send it himself. He would have made it look better. The guy that sent it was either drunk or not past the third grade because a baby could figure from the way he said it it wasn't an accident. Nobody gets shot in a hunting accident when the hunting season isn't open. That was enough. I gave up starving to death and headed for Detroit. That was Monday before last. 2 days after I got here, Cliff left the hospital and moved out to a little cottage on Grass Lake, confined to a wheelchair, knowing he'd never walk again. He was evasive at first and hard to get along with. He just sat there with a chip on his shoulder, continually bawling for a drink. He had changed a lot. A year ago, he had just finished high school, a football star, popular with the girls, and even pretty good in school. Sometimes I thought he dressed funny, but that was all in the age. If I had kept my job in Detroit and an eye on Cliff, everything would have been all right. But I was a little too unsettled for my own good. Maybe he got some of his wildness from me. But where did I get it? From what I can remember, the folks couldn't have been better. Doing everything right and contributing to the old saying that only the good die young. I wish Cliff had remembered them better. If he had, he wouldn't have fallen in with the pool room crowd who filled him with the easy money idea. It was through one of them that he got the job in the local numbers bank. That was the start. In a few months, he moved farther uptown, dressed better, but now carried a revolver. He was an easy kid to like, so I can see how he moved up fast. But in that racket, you don't push too hard if the guys in front of you are heavy. Cliff was ambitious and liked to push. A state cop found him in the bushes alongside U.S. 16 about a mile this side of Farmington. He had been badly beaten and shot. They probably had every intention of killing him, I'm not sure, but the bullet only chipped the spine, went right through. If they had done a good job, he'd been better off. It took just a few days of watching him break up a little bit at a time before I decided what I was going to do. I thought about the cops and a dozen other things a member of the Better Citizens League would do, but I wasn't a better citizen, and I couldn't see how going to the cops would do any good. To them, he was just another mug who got what he deserved. If the guy who did it was picked up, he'd be out within 24 hours, no evidence. A dozen guys would swear they were having a beer with him the exact second that Cliff was shot. If anything was going to be done, it would have to be done by me. I didn't have any delusions of wiping out the whole racket or even the Detroit branch, but one guy was going to get it. The one who decided that Cliff was no longer useful. Finding out his identity was no easy job. Even when I poured everything except aftershave lotion into Cliff to make him loosen up. I'd drink along with him to make it look like a party, but either he'd pass out too soon or else he'd just get talking good, and I would. Last night I was pretty disgusted with my progress and was trying to think of where I could lay my hands on a torture wheel when he opened up out of a clear highball and gave me the whole story. He was really feeling sorry for himself, and it made me a little sick. But at the end of the story, I found out my man was Marty Carrito. At first, I was going to shoot him on sight. Nothing fancy, and to hell with the consequences. I found out where he hung out most of the time, took the better part of the afternoon and evening to drink some courage, and arrived at the Black and Tan about 11. I was planning on getting him outside somehow, and on his back in the gutter without further ado, when the cute idea hit me. He was prescribed to prolong the agony and make him sweat. What a dreamer. The first part was over, and I knew damn well if anybody was scared, it was only me. It was going on 1 a.m. when I turned up the narrow, muddy drive leading to the cottage. I turned sharply off the drive about 100 feet from the cottage and drove.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.